and welcome to the 12th meeting in 2016 of the Health and Sport Committee. And I would ask everyone at this point, as I normally do, to switch off mobile phones that can sometimes interfere with the sound system, but certainly can interfere with the committee proceedings. I would ask those present, though, to note that the colleagues and clerks are using tablet devices, which are instead of the hard copies of the papers. The first item on our agenda this morning is a declaration of interest, and I welcome Bob Doris back to the committee. Before I invite Mr. Doris to declare any relevant interests, I want to put on record and I'm sure the committee's thanks to Fiona McLeod, who joined us in the committee for that period, and indeed we worked with in the past on the health committee. Mr. Doris, I invite you to declare any relevant interest.
Thanks, Convener. Can I also thank Fiona McLeod, who took over on committee whilst I was on paternity leave, and in terms of any relevant interest, nothing out with what's in my publicly available declaration of interest, Convener.
Thank you for that. We now move to agenda item number two, which is the choice of Deputy Convener. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish Nationalist Party are eligible for nomination as Deputy Convener of the committee. This being the case, can I invite nominations for the position of Deputy Convener?
Can I move Mr. Bob Doris as Deputy Convener?
Thank you, Richard Lyle. Is there any other nominations? No. One nomination has been received then, and therefore ask the committee to agree that Bob Doris be chosen as Deputy Convener of the committee. Are we all agreed? Yes. Thank you. There is agreement, and congratulate Bob yet again. On the good to have you back anyway. Yes. That's good. We now move to agenda item number three, and I invite members to agree to take consideration of the evidence and social work complaints procedure at agenda item five, which is in private at this meeting. Are we all agreed? Yes. Thank you. We now then move to agenda item number four today, which is oral evidence on access to new medicines. We have with us Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary of Health, Wellbeing and Sport. Welcome, Cabinet Secretary. Dr. Rosemary Parr, Chief Pharmaceutical Officer of Scotland, Scottish Government. Angiolina Foster, CBE, Chief Executive, Healthcare Improvement Scotland. And Professor Jonathan Fox, Chairman, Scottish Medical Consortium. Can I welcome you all this morning? And can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief statement to the committee before we move to questions? Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. Very pleased to be here this morning to talk to the committee about access to new medicines. And as we enter the last few weeks of this Parliament, I think the committee should be very proud of its work in this area and the achievements made in increasing access to new medicines in Scotland. I think it's worth me just taking a moment to run through the main changes that have been made in the last 2 years, as it's quite a list. The SMC now hold their meetings in public with pharmaceutical company representatives part of those meetings. There's a new framework for considering ultra-orphan medicines. The patient and clinical engagement process has been introduced together with additional opportunities for companies to put forward a patient access scheme. SMC has seen an increase of around 40% in its acceptance rate for end-of-life orphan and ultra-orphan medicines, and a pilot of early dialogue with pharmaceutical companies is ongoing. I've heard much deserved praise for the public and patient engagement programme that SMC have put in place, and this work is being fostered with a pilot of sharing SMC decisions and confidence with patient groups ahead of publication. We've expanded and replaced the Rare Conditions Medicines Fund with the New Medicines Fund. The amount available has doubled twice in consecutive years and stands at £90 million this year, meaning that the financial support has been there to implement the increase in access to new medicines. The flexibility that the committee called for in individual patient treatment requests has delivered a tenfold increase in access to end-of-life orphan and ultra-orphan medicines, and there is a pilot ongoing of the peer-approved clinical system. An Area Drug and Therapeutics Committee Collaborative has been established and achieved some early successes in bringing together representatives from across Scotland. They've led national work to optimise medicines use, are supporting strengthened public involvement and developing and testing new categorisation and communication policy for formulary decisions. And the final development to note is that a formal programme of work for monitoring clinical effectiveness of cancer medicines in real-life settings has been established. Many of the changes I've mentioned have been delivered by the Scottish Medicines Consortium and Healthcare Improvement Scotland, and they should be commended for their dedication in making the changes that the Parliament and the Scottish Government asked for. So to take a phrase from you, Convener, have we got more yeses? Yes, without doubt we have, but we're not complacent and we need to continue to build on what has been achieved. There's more that needs to be done on fairer pricing of drugs for the NHS and ensuring that the patient voice is front and centre of decision making. A key next step for us is the independent New Medicines Review led by Dr. Brian Montgomery. This will officially launch on the 21st of March with a stakeholder event in Edinburgh. Dr. Montgomery will take stock of the progress to date and advise us on whether the systems we have in place are fit for the future.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We move our first questions, which are from Nanette Millen.
Thank you very much. I think I would share enthusiasm about the progress so far and agree that there's more to be made. I'd like to ask one or two questions, if I may, around the sort of distribution and spending of the New Medicines Fund. I was under the impression, and I gather it's not the case, that this was a fund that was held centrally that it could be applied for. I understand that it's actually distributed to NHS boards according to the NRAC formula. Could you tell me which it actually is, please?
Yeah, well, the New Medicines Fund has really ensured that boards can deliver what the Scottish Government and the Parliament's policy intentions are. So boards receive the resources. So in 2014-15 NHS boards had required 1.1 million to support SMC decisions and 20.5 million to support individual and group patient treatment requests from the New Medicines Fund. And any funding not required by NHS boards for that purpose in 2014-15 remains available in 2015-16 on top of the new allocation made in 2015-16. So we keep very close to boards around making sure that we monitor the use of the fund and ensuring that it's adequate to meet the needs of the board area, and we'll continue to do that. But yes, it is allocated to boards, but we do keep a very close monitoring on the level of resources.
There seemed to be a little lack of clarity amongst witnesses last week in the round table that we had as to which boards are using all their fund. I mean, the NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde said they, in fact, were using all theirs and perhaps needed more. Are other boards using all theirs, or is there some still floating around that's not used?
So we asked, we continue to ask boards to inform us immediately if they have any concerns about their funding allocation, I suppose mainly on the basis of it being sufficient to meet anticipated expenditure. No board has raised this as an issue with us. We do make clear to boards that they're expected to utilise their funds for the stated purpose over the lifetime of the fund. So it might be that they don't spend it in a particular financial year, but we would expect them to spend it over the lifetime of the fund. And we think there probably should be more transparency around how the New Medicines Fund has been utilised. We had planned to publish details of the number of patients treated and the relevant drugs, but the committee might be aware that there is a Freedom of Information request ongoing, wanting us to provide details of spend on the top 10 drugs, which has been an ongoing complicating factor, because releasing both patient numbers and spend per drug does pose a risk to commercial and confidence information on pricing. So once that process is concluded, we will publish that information that we were planning to, and hopefully that will provide a bit more information about how the fund is actually being spent.
I mean, I think that would be very welcome, because that was a point that was made, that people didn't know how many patients were being treated, what therapies were being were being provided for. So that's interesting. And going forward, do you think this fund will continue to be funded centrally? I mean, I know how it is funded at the moment from the PPRS, but do you think that's likely to continue into the future?
Well, obviously, what happens beyond the current PPRS agreement is an important point. The committee will be aware that it is a scheme that's negotiated between the UK government and the ABPI, which is the Association of British Pharmaceutical Industry. The Scottish Government and the other devolved nations had asked for inclusion in the previous negotiations, and unfortunately that was refused. But since then, there has been greater involvement of the Scottish Government in the operation of the current PPRS. And obviously, post-Smith Commission, there are discussions ongoing about how Scotland can be included in future negotiations and decisions, whatever form they may take. So we would be keen, if there are changes that the UK government wants to negotiate around that, we want to very much be involved, and I'm sure Wales and Northern Ireland do as well, in what that looks like. We have the support of groups like the Scottish Cancer Coalition on Scotland's involvement in future negotiations, because it is very, very important that we have a voice in those discussions should PPRS be replaced in the future.
Thank you. That's all my question, just now. Thanks.
Yeah, just some clarity, just to understand what this committee or a future committee will get and what timelines in terms of the breakdown of how the funds are spent in terms of new drugs that are recommended by NICE, those that are recommended by the SMC, those who are not recommended by the SMC. We can get all of those type of breakdown.
Well, we want to furnish me with as much information as possible. As I say, there has been this complicated factor around the FOI, and that has delayed us putting that information out. But we will provide as much information as we can. It's where information strays into the domain of commercial and confidence information that has obviously been negotiated with pharmaceutical companies price, and you know, there's obviously sensitivities there, but we want to be as full and transparent as possible. Rosemary, do you want to say a little bit?
Yeah, I think just to add to that, I think that is really important. I think that transparency, we would definitely want to give some information around that when we can. I think that would be important. I think the New Medicines Fund has been an absolute a real issue about trying to actually ensure that access has been increased, and I think that's really positive. So I think what it has done is allowed the NHS boards to deliver on the Scottish Government and the Parliament's policy intentions around increased access to new medicines. So I think that is an important area. And we would want to be certainly very involved when it comes to before December 18, before this fund may change, and how that goes into the future.
Okay. Anyone else? No? You know, if it's the government secretary's intention to publish all of that information, I don't presume if we're talking about total spend on drugs that were not recommended by NICE or SMC or whatever, that would get round the confidentiality or the business case?
I think we would want to publish as much information as possible. I suppose where it gets into difficult territory is where there could be an association made between, you know, individual patient numbers with a specific drug and the cost of that, because you could then work out price, and then there's commercially sensitive issues around the negotiation that the pharmaceutical companies may have around the issue of price. Anjali, do you want to say a little bit about that?
Simply to endorse, I think, the issue that has been raised, which is in terms of our fundamental desire for maximum transparency, the trade-off in there is this issue around commercial and confidence, and we just need to be careful not to create unintended difficulties there.
Yeah, and from the committee's point of view, we're trying to judge what would have been available, what's now available, which was not available in the past, which gives us are more yeses, and we should say at the start here that the evidence that we've had in written forum and the oral session reflects what the committee feels and the cabinet secretary feels, that we are making good progress here. So we're not trying to be negative in that sense. In terms of the the fact that the New Medicine Fund of Scotland is funded by the rebate the industry makes with the PPRS, and some evidence we had last week, I think from Glasgow Clyde, that there was a I don't know where it can be accurately described as a funding shortfall, but there was a funding issue this year. Is that a result of the rebate reducing in the shorter term? Does that give us challenges, or what do we anticipate that rebate will be able to fund the existing scheme going forward? And we'll probably discuss before this session finishes what the future will look like and how that will be funded. But in terms of the evidence that we heard last week?
Yeah, I mean, the actual PPRS receipts are expected to be lower than was expected. That's across the whole of the UK, not just an issue for us. It's an issue across the board. I guess in some ways there is an estimate. It's based on an estimate of what the receipts are that you would expect to receive. We'll have to manage that. We would work very closely with boards to make sure that we manage that budget and ensure at the end of the day that the most important thing here is that patients receive the support that they require, the fund is used in the most appropriate way. As I've said, there is an ability to manage that over a number of years so that it's not there's not such pressure in one financial year, and that's what we'll work with boards to ensure that happens. Now, I guess this would be an issue we would want to be around the table and discussing about any schemes that would replace PPRS, because at the moment we do have a system that is you estimate, you then build your fund on the basis of that, and there can be issues where that isn't in sync. We have a bit of that this year. Last year wasn't the case, that was different. We don't know what will happen in future years. So perhaps as part of a review of PPRS, we would want to look at whether we can better match the anticipated receipts. I'm not sure how we would do that, but it would be good if we could better anticipate the receipts that we're going to get and the funding that would come in when we set the budget for our new medicines fund.
So the shortfall this year, as described in evidence last week from Glasgow Clyde, will not impact on patients or patient access to new medicines?
No. I mean, we'll work with boards to manage that and make sure that there's no detriment to patients.
Will that mean the Scottish Government will make up that shortfall this year?
Well, as I say, we've asked boards whether they are anticipating any problems with the resources that they have, with the demand that they have, and at the moment they're telling us they don't, but we're keeping a very close eye on that. So boards are not saying that we are not going to be able to manage the resources we have with patient demand, but if required, then obviously
just a matter of interest, that include Glasgow Clyde Health Board, who came along and said last week there is a shortfall. Right, but it's not something that going to impact on patients. It can be overcome either by the health boards or by the Scottish Government. Forecasting in the future, is there any way to forecast whether this will be just a blip this year, or will this impact over the next term?
Yeah, that's a very good point. I think horizon scanning in this area is quite difficult, and it is difficult, I think, to predict future spend. But the Scottish Government works with HIS and the boards themselves on horizon scanning for the new medicines fund expenditure. So we work quite closely with boards to do that. And this is a continuous process. So that's actually how we actually draw up our horizon scans for boards as part of their financial planning. So we work quite closely with boards to do that. And this also includes some financially sensitive information and is an ongoing process with estimations there. So I think we would want to continue to do that and improve our horizon scanning as much as possible.
So does that mean there'll be increasing pressure on the money to fund the scheme, or does it not?
I think there probably will be increasing pressure around the money for the new medicines fund, but it's definitely not at risk just now. We have information. No, so I think that's reasonable.
But it is an issue that needs to be looked at in the review or whatever.
We would certainly want to take the independent review to take stock of all that progress to date. And I think that would be a really positive thing to do for Dr. Montgomery. I think the other key area we would like to look at in the other aspect is also to look at commercial negotiation on price as well. So that under our current system, potentially we could do better to get a better price, and we want to look at those improvements there as well. So the New Medicines Fund is very important, and it has allowed boards, I think, to increase access to new medicines, and that's shown by an increase of around 40% of acceptance rate by SMC across those areas for end-of-life orphan and ultra-orphan conditions. But we would definitely want to, going forward, negotiate better on price so that Scotland gets better value for the price of that New Medicines Fund.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll come to that. Malcolm Chisholm.
Two of the issues that were prominent in the oral evidence, which you may have seen, and also in the written evidence, were the PACE and the IPTR. So in terms of PACE, I think people really appreciated the extent of patient and clinician involvement. But I think two questions arose from our evidence in relation to PACE. Firstly, you know, it was good to have, as it were, pre-meetings, but there was concern that there were no there was no possibility for patients or clinicians to be questioned at the final SMC meeting, and quite a few submissions and evidence last week suggested that would be beneficial. And I think the second issue was an issue about the evaluation of the decision-making by the SMC, and particularly the impact of PACE on that. So I don't know whether we have any information on that or whether there are any proposals to evaluate it, but I would say those were the two main issues that came up in relation to PACE, but it was obviously very positive in terms of what PACE has achieved so far.
Yeah, I think like you've said, you've received pretty positive feedback from patient groups about how their views are being taken on board and into account through PACE. One of the specific areas I've asked Dr. Montgomery to look at is the very point about whether there's more that needs to be done around that. You've mentioned one specifically around the end point and of decision making. So, you know, I that's why we've made huge progress, but we know that there's always more that can be done. There's further improvements that I'm sure that can be made, and Dr. Montgomery will look at that, and if there are recommendations that he thinks, you know, could further improve the system, then I'm sure he will make those recommendations.
Okay, and I mean, I'll just kick off on the IPTR. I'm sure colleagues will want to follow up on it, but I suppose the key issues around IPTR were to do with consistency and transparency, and I think, you know, people had various comments about how that those issues might be addressed. But again, while welcoming the you know, the extent to which IPTR had delivered more positive results for patients, there was concern about consistency between different boards in their decision-making process and the transparency of the process. So I don't know whether there are any proposals to deal with that, or to what extent PACS, when it does get rolled out, will address those issues.
So I think, as you've recognised as well, the fact that the extension to the flexibility that the committee called for has led to the tenfold increase from the time of the committee's inquiry. So I think we can think about specific examples of where that has worked. And I know you've heard evidence directly from those who have benefited. I mean, we've been clear from the outset that there should be a reduction in the reliance on this route to access medicines as a result of changes made at SMC, and the forthcoming review will test how that has worked, really, as part of Dr. Montgomery's review. If PACS, a system in which there is intended to be much less reliance than there had been for IPTR, had been rolled out in May 2014, then I think this would have been ahead of a body of decisions by SMC under their new process. And as we've said, the extension and flexibility has allowed 500 patients to access orphan, ultra-orphan drugs in 2014 that at the time were not recommended by SMC. So I think, you know, in terms of the rolling out of PACS, that has really coloured our view of how that should be done, which is why we went to the pilot, because we recognised something was working quite well and we didn't want to jeopardise that by then moving too quickly to a new system. So that's why we have the pilot in Glasgow and Clyde. I think it's also fair to say that boards have adapted their decision-making. They have applied the flexibility in a way that we've seen the numbers, so the evidence is there to show that they have. Obviously, the medicines, the new medicines fund being there has supported that change of approach, which has been very important. There's always, though, going to be individual decisions and individual circumstances. I don't think any system can wholly get away from that. So whether it's IPTR or whether it's PACS, there will always be that element. Guidance to boards states that they should share best practice, and we have encouraged that, and we're, you know, as I say, keeping a very close eye as well on decisions that are made either way. So I think we are in a better place. We're moving forward with caution around the pilot and moving to that new system over time. We want to make sure that we continue with the positive improvements that we've seen. But in amongst all of that, there will still obviously sometimes be decisions, whether it's under IPTR or whether it's under the new PAC system, that, you know, will be unpopular and will be difficult. And no system will ever perfectly address that, I don't believe. But I think we are in a much better place than we were previously.
I mean, could you explain, just final question from me, you know, the main ways in which PACS is different from IPTR, or to what extent, you know, it's being piloted, but is that really about the detail, or are there still some fundamental questions that you're exploring about PACS?
So the changes being tested through the pilot are the focus on capturing measurable clinical benefit and monitoring the outcomes and adverse events. So that's a key part of it. The approach of the prescribing clinician leading on seeking peer support and individual patient on an individual patient basis, the use of a panel of clinicians to provide oversight of the cases put forward, and the consistency this delivers. So I suppose that is the kind of the focus of PACS, very much the clinician being at the centre of it, but with oversight of that. There's nothing in the pilot so far, Rosemary can maybe say a bit more than that, that would cause us any alarm in any way. We think that there's some good information that will come out of the pilot, not least, I think, trying to capture more and measure clinical benefit, because what the thing that I think we're less good at is actually seeing what happens when a drug is out there with a patient. Is it delivering what it was supposed to deliver? Is it delivering more? Is it delivering less? How do we capture some of that information and feed that back potentially into the SMC for future reference, and perhaps trying to complete the circle of real-time information? Rosemary, do you want to say?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's right. I think we are being cautious on the pilot for this rollout for peer-approved clinical system, and I think that's the right approach. And I think we do want to look at the outcomes of that. And I think that'll be very important, I think, in going forward, involving more of the clinician as well on an individual basis. And those systems like IPTR and PACS, I think, hopefully in the longer term, we would want to see less reliance on those systems. So the SMC decisions would really be the ones that we would want to stick with on that kind of national basis. However, I think in going forward, seeing what will happen with the pilot and any rollout of that, we'll look at that through the independent review, and I think we are open to and prepared to make further changes if necessary. And I think, as the Cabinet Secretary said, this is a really interesting and difficult area for some people, so I think that's really helpful that we do it with caution. I think also to add, finally from me, I think we want to see the main route for access to pharmaceutical companies is actually putting a good case through SMC and putting forward that good quality submission with a fair price and offering at SMC for the first time, and really not by any other route. So I think that's what we'd like to see mostly. So we will take all of those routes into account.
Thank you. I'd just like to offer a couple of extra comments in relation to the first part of Mr. Chisholm's question about pace. I think, Mr. Chisholm, you were asking, might it be desirable for
patients and clinicians who have been part of PACE to also be present at the SMC meeting. And I just wanted to mention that one of the bits of organisational arrangements that we have very deliberately put in place has been a thing called the Patient Involvement Network. So that's a support mechanism and a consultative mechanism whereby we are looking at how the current arrangements may evolve over time in a spirit of continuous improvement. So my sense is that from the point of view of our internally driven, so to speak, continuous improvement, the Patient Involvement Network may well be the place where proposals such as that may come from and then be looked at and mature. Your second aspect of your PACE point, I think, was around the impact. And I think my observation there would be simply that the figures, I genuinely believe, do speak for themselves there in terms of the outcomes of the SMC decisions before and after the introduction of PACE. And lastly, I'm sure Professor Fox will wish to speak for himself, but I know that he is always very clear with his committee members about the importance that they ought to place around the output from the PACE meetings as a really crucial part of the deliberations of his committee.
Thank you. Rhoda, a supplementary on that question, and any others who wish to pursue some of those points in the process?
Yeah, just around the IPTR system and how it operates currently, we're still getting people expressing concerns that some people are getting access to medicines that others aren't. And I think that looks a bit starker if you're both being treated by the same clinicians but come from different health boards. And so one then imagines it's not about whether the treatment can actually make a difference, because one would imagine that the information coming from the same clinicians is the same. So I'm wondering what health boards are basing their decisions on those requests currently. How transparent is that, and how that will change going forward?
But ultimately, though, the clinical decision might be that one patient may benefit from that treatment, but another patient may not, or the side effects may be such that that patient's clinical condition couldn't tolerate. So what we don't know, I suppose, is what are the clinical discussions with the clinical needs of the patient. We just don't know that. So although it may appear, that a clinician has made either a different decision in two patients' cases about the same drug, or that two health boards have made a differing decision about a drug and a patient, what we don't know is, well, what are the different circumstances of the patient, and they may be quite different. However, having said that, we do keep a very close eye on making sure that if we were to become aware of what we would see as a process that raises questions, then we would look at that and we would ask pertinent questions about that. But I think the fact that overall we have seen a different approach, and we've seen that across all health boards, the numbers speak for themselves and wouldn't be such if that wasn't the case. And ultimately, it, as I said to Malcolm Chisholm, yes, there will be occasions where difficult decisions are made. What we would expect, though, is that those are based on clinical judgments, and that there is a fair process around that boards would use the best practice and best guidance in how they approach, whether it's IPTR or indeed in the future a PAC system. But I mean, if you're aware of any cases that you think are standout ones that you would want us to look at, and if you think that that hasn't been the case, then by all means, you should preferably let myself know, and we'll have a look at that.
I mean, how much work have you carried out with clinicians who would be in that situation, who would see a difference between, for instance, taking the Beats, for example? Do you speak to them? Do you do you listen to what they say about different health boards giving the okay for different drugs? Because they would be the people that would know, because they're treating the patients and they would know the information they're feeding back to the health boards, and they would know if they were getting different outcomes. I mean, it seems to me, and I don't have a case, but certainly anecdotally what seems to be coming back is if you're in a different health boards treat that slightly differently.
Yeah, we do. Rosemary, do you want to say a bit more?
Absolutely.
About it?
Yeah, I mean, it is an interesting area, and I think what we have to say is that patient numbers in these areas are quite small, so it's actually quite difficult to interrogate the data. But the data we do have to date does not give any evidence of a postcode lottery. So there is something there about, I think, people perhaps having that impression. But I think what we are seeing is that individual decisions are for individual patients. And I think it's right and proper that sometimes these decisions are different. I think what we can point to is the fact that before the policy changes were made, around 50 patients accessed orphan, ultra-orphan and end-of-life medicines through the IPTR route. And by 14-15, that had increased to over 500 patients. So I think we are seeing increased access, even though those numbers are actually quite small. And we only really have any anecdotal evidence of any postcode lottery, and we don't think that really does back up these claims. I think what we can do in Scottish Government would absolutely help and want to bring forward is that sharing of boards' information. And you've heard that last week, I think, from some of the clinicians, that for some of these very small areas, that clinicians sharing that information together is a really good thing. So we would absolutely encourage that to happen.
Thanks for that. I mean, I think, you know, you'll have been aware, and others, of the written evidence that we've had in some of these issues, and the oral evidence we had last week, and everybody made, most people are making the point that it's evolution that we're talking about here. It's not a criticism of the progress that has been made, and I think it's worth, just putting that on the agenda again, with that. Bob.
Thanks, convener. I was going to return a little bit to the subject of price. I was listening carefully. Rosemary Parr said you want to get a better, negotiate better on price for the NHS. And the Cabinet Secretary said, I think, want to get the best deal for the NHS. And if I quote from Angiolina Foster's submission to the committee ahead of this evidence session, it says, Healthcare Improvement Scotland believes that the assessment process is best served by pharmaceutical companies offering a competitive price from the outset. The price considered is the assessment. In the assessment may involve a patient access scheme. And throughout all that, woven between it, of course, is the fact we have commercial confidentiality as well. But the theme I'm getting again and again and again is we can do better on price. That can only mean that pharmaceutical companies are charging more than we would expect to pay for medicines. The obvious benchmark for myself would be, are we getting as good a deal as, say, they're getting in England in relation to this? And I would be keen to know, are we negotiating as hard as we can on price? Are the pharmaceutical companies coming to the table to give the best possible deal? I spend much of my time working constructively with pharmaceutical companies as key stakeholders, but they're also private companies at the same time, and getting that balance between maximising shareholder profit and their corporate and social responsibilities and the balances they have there can be quite tricky. So given that price has come up repeatedly in relation to the evidence this morning, are we getting the best deal, and what more can we do, and how does it compare to elsewhere in the UK?
Okay, well, I think this is a really, really important area going forward. Well, has been already, but very, very important going forward. So we've been monitoring this issue very closely, and not just in relation to those medicines that fall within SMC's new approach, but generally. And I mean, I think the short answer is that we don't always get to the company's best price first time around, or even at all. And I should be clear that I'm not, that not all of the pharmaceutical industry behaves in the same way when it comes to pricing. But while companies are absolutely entitled to take commercial decisions on how they wish to price their drugs, it's incumbent on all of us to ensure that the NHS has systems in place so that the best value is achieved, and the need for example, time-consuming resubmissions to SMC is avoided. We take the review that there should be external commercial negotiations linked with the SMC process. I think the pharmaceutical industry could also do better on fairer pricing without unduly impacting on returns for their shareholders. And if we get that into a better place, it means that things like the New Medicines Fund can go further, supporting more people in Scotland. And you know, we would expect if a pharmaceutical company is able to offer a better price elsewhere, that there's no reason that they can't offer that better price to the NHS in Scotland as well. So, you know, this is an area that we have, again, I've asked Brian Montgomery to look at how we can make those improvements. There are potential ways within the systems of trying to get an earlier discussion to avoid getting to the position at the end of the process where a better price is then offered on resubmission that could have been offered in the first place. And yet, you know, sometimes months has elapsed within that period. So there are definitely some process issues that can be improved to get to that better position. But there's also, I think, a bit of, as I've said, that we think there should be some external commercial negotiations linked with the SMC process that can drive drive towards a fairer price, and that's something we are very, very keen to pursue. I don't know whether.
I absolutely agree. I think only the thing to add to that is the Scottish Government can monitor price very closely because we do have access to commercial and confidence information, so that allows us to do that. So that's how we can see it. In going forward, we think there could be definitely some areas of improvement there. And I think that would help us allow areas like the New Medicines Fund to be used and to go further. So I think we would like to see that as part of what may come out of the review, to see how we can do that better.
I don't know if any other witnesses want to add to that
just to make it clear, I agree with everything that's been said, but SMC itself does not negotiate on price. It would be a conflict with its role in medicines assessment. Just one additional point about getting the best deal is that the new PACE process as well, or the new processes as well as the PACE meeting, does allow the companies to come back with a new or improved patient access scheme or confidential discount. And that has helped on a number of occasions to improve the cost effectiveness of the medicines. And I think we've had about 7 of those occurrences, and 4 of which have resulted in eventual acceptance. So there is, you know, that has helped the ability to get the medicine at the best price, I would say.
Okay, that's very helpful. I should point out, Convener, that I have met pharmaceutical companies frequently and often. I should point out for the record that I've never been paid to meet them, and it's done in a constructive, collegiate way in my role on this committee. But the point I would make is an important one. I've never met a company yet that doesn't say that they're in this for the best interest of the patients and for the people they serve. And therefore, if there are better deals being struck elsewhere in the UK, I'm sure they would want to look at that very carefully and work constructively for the Scottish Government to make sure that Scotland gets a better deal than we're currently doing. And I'm sure they're listening to the exchange that we've just had. Moving the debate on a little bit, we're also hoping to develop a Scottish model of value, something that this committee was very keen to see during evidence we had on value-based pricing back in the day when we were doing our initial inquiry and access to new medicines. I'd be quite keen to hear about any update in relation to that. And in particular, my interest has always been about where clinical evidence from trials is maybe not as mature as it could be, or there's not a kind of a longevity to that evidence. Apologies if my terminology lets me down here, but I suppose what I mean is it's results-based reimbursement, for lack of a better description, and maybe even reimbursement in instalments. Because one of the things about whether someone can sustain employment for longer because of getting a medicine, or their social care needs are less because of getting a pharmaceutical intervention, that's time release savings to the health and social care sector, but it's upfront costs to the NHS for medicine. So it's in that context that I would view any Scottish model of value. And I have to say pharmaceutical companies would be key stakeholders to working in partnership to develop that. So is there any progress on that? Where are we with that? Can we hope to see something in the near future?
Yeah, so I mean, we said from the outset that the new approach adopted by SMC would be the first step in developing a Scottish model of value, and the independent review under Dr. Montgomery will consider whether the progress made to date provides a solid base for developing this concept further. I think some of the points you make are very fair. Rosemary, did you want to say?
Yeah, I agree. I think there will be a lot of interest, both from, I think, patient groups and the industry, to see how we do build on that model of value as we go forward. And I think I would absolutely say that the new approach is part of that. So when we say that we have a new framework for end-of-life medicines, ultra-orphan and orphan drugs, then these include modifiers in how that type of value can be taken forward as well. The patient and public involvement and the PACE process and the pilot packs can all be added to that. I think that model and how we take things forward. So that would be a solid movement on the way forward. I think there are... also, I think issues about trying to look at evidence and outcomes, and I would agree with your point that sometimes the narrative isn't just always about access to new drugs, it's how they're used and what actually the outcomes we do get from that too. So we definitely will be looking at aspects of how the context of looking at new medicines and what evidence they have and what they deliver, both for the patient and for the NHS as well. And we would certainly look at, and I think we expect the review to look at that type of real-time health technology assessment, I think, which you were referring to. And this would definitely need further consideration for policy and practice going into the future, but we would want to look at that as part of the wider group. And also, I think, to see what nationally and internationally companies are doing and countries are doing around health technology assessment. I think that would be very positive to go into that view too.
Okay, no further questions, Kira. Thank you.
Professor Fox, there was one of the issues that was raised that you say the SMC don't negotiate in price, but one of the, I suppose, the issues that has been raised by people of access to those new medicines, that sometimes nothing very much changes other than the price and then the new medicine that's made available, you know, and what we're getting in evidence that sort of sours that principle that price doesn't really matter when in the process itself, if the price changes, then the drug that has been tied to access does become available. So, you know, that process is important to people. We heard in written evidence and last week. And there's also the issue about the openness, and the pharmaceutical companies were saying, well, if we knew more about the initial discussion, whether this is right or wrong, if we knew more about why that new drug or medicine was refused, then we would be able to respond quicker. So the process itself has been criticised by all sides. The government, that it's not working for them in terms of price. The patient who's denied access and it takes longer time to access that medicine, sometimes too late because of the process. The negotiation, you know, rightly or wrongly, that takes place. Let's hear what you've got to say. We might barely offer you, you know, so it's... To all intents and purposes, there is a negotiation there, and the process has been highlighted as one of the problems that you know, one of the issues that's causing problems. Will these type of issues be addressed by the review, and how?
I mean, this is a key issue that Dr. Montgomery's review will consider about how do we get to the nub of the issue of the best price as early on in the process as possible to avoid the scenario that you've described. And how can we have an external process that's linked to the SMC process, but is basically driving that discussion at an early enough stage that is, you know, can result in a, you know, what do we want out of this? We want the best price, the fairest price at the earliest stage of the process as possible to avoid what you've described as a, you know, at the end of the process or a resubmission, then coming back. With a different offer. So You know, this is absolutely one of the key issues that, Dr. Montgomery has been asked to, look at, so that we can really focus on getting the right set of procedures in place. Some of that will no doubt be external to SMC, but will have to feed into SMC in the right way, and that's really a key ask of, Dr. Montgomery to take that forward.
Are we more likely to get a better price from pharmaceutical companies if we work with the UK government or the European government, so, who are all competing? You know, that's the market. So if I can sell a drug in Italy that they're prepared to pay twice the money for, how do we circumvent some of that market? How do we get, with our population size and our demand and spend, get a better price than our next door neighbours with 60 million people? You know, is there opportunities here for governments to work together to ensure better pricing, rather than seeking a Scottish solution to taking on global companies? Angiolina Foster.
Well, if thank you, Convener. If it's helpful, in my mind, at any rate, I sense there are three quite distinct concepts that we're wrestling with here. Uh-huh. So the first is the pursuit of the best possible price for Scotland.
Possible.
In a commercial context.
Right.
And I think the point that you're rightly flagging, Convener, is that it's a global marketplace, and therefore any improvement in the processes that Scotland deploys for commercial negotiation will need to recognise the global nature of that marketplace. So that's concept one, if you will. That's the commercial issues. Number two for me is the question of the overall affordability of the drugs bill for Scotland's NHS. And that is quite distinct, and it's clearly a policy and value issue. The third concept is one of cost and clinical cost effectiveness. And it is that third area, and only that third area, that is the business of SMC's professional and public deliberations. I don't know if you want to say more than that, Jonathan, but if it's helpful, those are three things that clearly
yes.
interplay, but the mechanisms and the possible maturing of each of those three things may take separate routes.
Yeah, depending on what system is developed for price negotiation, depending on whereabouts in the process it happens, then of course SMC's expertise can be very valuable in informing that without taking part in it specifically. So that's undeniable. As far as how to get the best price is concerned, well, of course, having a health technology appraisal system like SMC has, I believe, helped that, in that without it, it would be a far less easily, it would be a market that was far less controlled. And you talked about how price might still be a factor. And it clearly is. Access to new medicines cannot come at any price. I think that's been stated many times, even by patient groups. What we've done very deliberately is increase flexibility at the after the advice of this committee and the instruction of the Cabinet Secretary a few years ago. So there's no question that increased flexibility has increased access to these medicines. There are still, and also in the case of ultra orphan medicines, we've downgraded the importance of the cost effectiveness information. But overall, cost effectiveness, value for money, still has to play some part in drug decision making.
By the SMC.
Yes.
And is the current procedure for dealing with that, the Collie and all of this, do you still consider that the appropriate way to evaluate these?
for the great majority of medicines, remember we deal with a lot of medicines that are not for end of life and not for very rare conditions. For the great majority of medicines, that is an appropriate, absolutely appropriate
at the current level and caps?
That is actually outside my personal domain, and it is an interesting argument. I think you heard evidence 3 years ago about what the true cost of the Collie might be in the NHS. But again, we have conventional ways of assessing these medicines. They're not strict thresholds. There are various issues that can be considered as well as the strict cost per Collie. And clearly, as I say, the flexibility we've now given to some kinds of medicines is much increased. But yes, it is a proper way, or a way. We've also offered the opportunity with the very rare conditions, the ultra orphans, of using other kinds of argument, let's say. But that's still in quite an early stage.
Yeah. Is that something that needs to be developed?
Yeah, well, we're continually trying to develop that. It's again, a question of our relationship with the pharmaceutical companies and getting to understand what may be acceptable in those unusual circumstances.
Yes. Is that something that will be dealt with the review as well, Cabinet Secretary, the cost per Collie and the rare and orphan diseases? Mm-hmm. Good. You want supplementary in that? Or?
Yeah, apologies, Richard. Apologies, Rhoda, then. Just in terms of cost per Collie, we have to be slightly careful because I remember, and apologies if I now get the numbers wrong, but a rule of thumb, again, back in the day when we did our initial inquiry, was, I know there's no such thing as a bog standard drug, but, you know, 25,000 to 35,000 you were coming in, depending on the clinical evidence, and that would be affordable. But by having such a kind of rigid crib sheet, if you're a pharmaceutical company and you might be prepared to settle for £20,000, if you know the cost per Collie threshold is 35,000, why would you not put a bid in at 35,000 at the top end? So is there, I know Mr. Fox doesn't deal with those pricing and negotiations, but is there a real politique in those discussions in relation to you have to be slightly careful in setting out a rigid crib sheet and what cost per Collie is? Because why wouldn't a company just go into the top end of it and maximise a profit if it can do so? Is there a little health warning that comes with the cost per Collie chat also?
Yes. The fact is that one... there is, in the real world, competition also helps. Remember that after the SMC, there is scope for tendering and price cost negotiations. So in the case of some medicines, even after they've been accepted at a certain cost, because, of course, that can include the confidential discounts, it's not the list price necessarily, then there's opportunities at national or local level for some further negotiation. I guess this is the difference between what might be regarded as a cost-effective, as a price which allows cost-effectiveness, and the best price, which the Cabinet Secretary mentioned in her opening statement.
Okay, and is that where the independent commercial discussions could take place? In tandem with, but not as part of that SMC process?
I mean, it would obviously have to relate to the SMC process, and it would have to provide an input, and it would have to work out how that would happen. But yes, and that's what we've asked Dr. Montgomery to look at. You know, how might that work? How might we, what synergy would it have? And just the practicalities of how it would sit alongside, who would do it, how it would work in practice. But, I'm very, very clear as Cabinet Secretary that getting the best price, which obviously will be a fair price, but getting the best price for Scottish patients and indeed Scottish taxpayers is very, very important. And we believe there is room for improvement there. And, we want to make sure that we get the best deal.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you. Can I ask about co-payments where patients decide themselves to fund their own access to medicine? Has this declined with the new system? Because that was one of the major issues of the old system, where some patients could afford and did go on to access new medicines, but others couldn't.
Do you want to say something about co-payments?
Yeah, absolutely. There is some extant CMO guidance, I think from 2009, that covers more than medicines, but it was introduced to allow work on access to medicines in a previous parliament. This does remain in place, although we are not aware that the provisions have been widely used. Scottish Government doesn't hold that information centrally, so that would be really information held at boards. But again, we don't think, although that is in place, we're not aware that provisions have been widely used around that. I think there is something there that patients, if they are paying significant amounts of money for treatments that don't give a great deal of benefit, I think we would be quite concerned about that. And I think leading on to that, I suppose going through and into the review, the CMOs work on realistic medicine, and that area around how we want to speak to patients about shared decision making might be an opportunity to discuss this further. So there might be that kind of shared decision making between the clinician and the patient themselves to actually look at some of these areas. Some of these drugs can be very difficult to take and quite toxic, and that end of life discussion I think is very important.
I mean, I think if it had been a wide scale issue, I would have known about it and people would be raising it with me on a regular basis, and that's just not been the case. Obviously, it's something we need to keep a close eye on, but you know, I certainly am not aware from you know issues being raised with me that this is something that is a common occurrence.
Okay. I don't think it's a common occurrence, but I think it occurs, and we had evidence, going back to where we were looking at the system previously, there was issues around people who were paying for their own medicines, then paying for treatment they would have received free on the NHS because they were already paying for medicines. So some of the treatment they would have been entitled to free for their condition, scans, blood tests, the like, they then had to pay for it. And my understanding is that that has now changed in that they would receive the, they would pay for the drug separately, but they would receive the treatment on the NHS. But there's some concerns about delays around who pays for what, and I'm just looking for some information on that as to how that could be speeded up to make sure there was no delays in treatment. I think one of the examples we were given was someone actually only got access to the drug treatment that they were looking for weeks before their death, where had the co-payments been sorted out sooner, they would have had treatment to that drug sooner.
I mean, I'm certainly happy to look into particular cases like that. I mean, I think you've said quite rightly that you know there's been was it CMO's guidance that changed that to make sure that that those issues that you cited about the other aspects of someone's treatment other than drugs were resolved. And as I say, I think these are such small numbers of cases that you know we need to obviously have, I suppose, the permission or relative permission to look into any individual cases. But you know, I'm certainly happy to do that if there are still issues around timing and so on, but they're very, as I understand it, we're talking about very, very small numbers of cases here, and ultimately it still has to be a clinical judgment about whether or not someone would be, you know, well harmed potentially by deciding to go ahead with treatment if the clinician is of a different view. So the clinical judgment in these matters is still very, very important. But, you know, I will look into the circumstances you raise.
Yeah, that would be useful, because one assumes that if the clinician, if the system were working right and the clinician thought that this drug treatment was going to be beneficial, then surely there would be access in some form if it was going to be greatly, so that people wouldn't have to look at funding that treatment themselves. And I think that was also an issue historically, where those who could afford access treatment and those who couldn't. So it would be good to look at all of that around and see, one, if that's happening, kind of, you know, is NHS treatment being provided free and quickly? And two, what circumstances that's happening, and should the system not be picking up on it?
Okay, we'll do that.
Thanks, Rhoda. Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I've got several questions. One of which, within these islands, we have the context of the United Kingdom, two distinct, made up of several countries, but two distinct countries, Scotland and England. In England we have NICE, and in Scotland we have SMC. One of the comments that's always made to me by patients is, down in England, NICE accept a drug and it's then brought to SMC, and SMC don't. Why is that? And should we not be working together where either we have accepted a drug or they have accepted a drug, that the work that's been done on that acceptance should then be taken on board by the other organisation, or vice versa?
Well, it works both ways, of course. There are drugs that are approved by NICE that there's a different view taken by SMC, but there are similarly drugs approved by SMC that NICE takes a different view of. I'll hand over to Angiolina in a second, but interestingly, I think as the decision's just been made, for example, to bring the Cancer Drugs Fund into NICE, and I think there obviously have been various views expressed about that, but our approach has been different in that we believed that it was important to have a sustainable position, that in our view around the Cancer Drugs Fund, we had concerns that that this was going to be pretty short term, and then what? And I think the then what is now that the Cancer Drugs Fund is going into NICE and essentially will be absorbed through the NICE processes, and concerns are being raised because until that happened, there was a different process. We've taken a more sustainable view of making the improvements incrementally and not kind of putting all our eggs in one basket, if you like, with all the difficulties that has now followed for the Cancer Drugs Fund. Angeline.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. It's a good challenge, may I say, but I'm going to ask Professor Fox to give you a more detailed explanation.
Okay. SMC started, about 14 years ago now, and its mission role was to assess all new medicines or significant new indications for medicines. And we've done that, and we continue to do that. NICE has never had quite that remit, so there have been differences from the beginning. NICE selects medicines to appraise. So given this philosophy that Scotland should have a system that appraises all new medicines, that's one of the answers, I guess. The next one, of course, is the notion of the population perhaps in Scotland, or the circumstances of the population in Scotland being different to those in the whole of the United Kingdom. And then increasingly, there's the fact that the NHS in Scotland is rather different from the NHS in England. So I'm giving you a number of reasons why I believe that the SMC should continue to exist. I would say that, of course, but I think they are relevant. Now, do we cooperate with NICE? Well, we certainly do, because one thing that NICE can do, and incidentally, NICE produces excellent output. I have no question about that. It's rather more the process traditionally has been very much slower than ours. We've tried to get our decisions quickly so that we can shape future practice rather than having to change established practice. So as well as being comprehensive, we've also been rapid, and still are rather rapid, even with the small increased times related to the PACE process. So I think there are significant... Oh, I was going to tell you where we do cooperate. Well, we obviously talk to each other and discuss each other or read each other's output and cooperate on more levels than that. But in particular, there's a thing called the multiple technology appraisal, where NICE is able to compare many existing medicines or other treatments within a specific disease area. And that's something we don't do, and that can be very useful. It's often not of brand new medicines, clearly. It's a market where, or an area, a therapeutic area, where there are many or several medicines. And we usually do adopt those via Healthcare Improvement Scotland. We have a mechanism for accepting those for use in Scotland and superseding, if we accept them, previous SMC advice. So we do work closely in that respect.
Can I say I'm not suggesting that SMC be done away with and taken over by NICE? Quite the reverse. The point I was making is that people are saying to me, why is it I can get it in it? People can get it in England, but we can't get it in Scotland. Yeah. I know we're taking steps. But in some ways, I think you let the cat out of the bag earlier by suggesting, Professor Jonathan Fox, that the eventual acceptance of a drug is based on price. Now, I know that last week several people were suggesting that we should have a hard negotiator that should go in and negotiate the price. Is a drug eventually accepted in Scotland if the drugs company comes back and says, well, we made a mistake, or we can negotiate or whatever? Is that a real... And I'll give notice that I've got another question after this.
OK, I think we should distinguish first between the bulk of medicines that we deal with, which are not in the end of life or very rare conditions categories. And in those cases, although we don't state a specific threshold, clearly the cost per quali, of which cost, not the list price, but the cost that it represents to the NHS Scotland, in Scotland, compared to the benefits it brings, is a specific factor, a major factor. Now, I do want to correct something from the last meeting, which is this business of it's just the cost. It isn't. It's not just the price or the cost of the medicine. We take into account all the healthcare-related costs in the conventional process even for the new medicine compared to the comparator medicine, the previous medicine. So it's not by any means just the price of the medicine. It's all costs. That includes the costs of not using the medicine. That is, if there are consequences of not using the new medicine, that's all taken into account. As I've said, in the new process, we have a lot more flexibility, and that's been shown by the increased acceptance rates that we've had. And indeed, in the ultra-orphan medicines, these are medicines for people with very few, under 100 or thereabouts, people affected in Scotland, it's even less important. But I have to say, it is difficult to sustain an argument that access to medicines can come at any price, given the enormous price of some of the new medicines that are coming to market.
Yeah, well, I, like Bob Doris, have had meetings with certain companies, and the first thing I've said to him is, you know, your medicines are too dear. You know, you'll need to, you know, let's live. And I think I'll go back to a point you made. Let's live in the real world. And the real world is, we want the best for the people in Scotland, but we also want it at the best price, and I agree with you. Can I move on to something that I don't know, and you may wish to enlighten us on? How the membership of SMC, or the members who sit on the SMC, and the comments made about patient representative being on it or not, who makes up, I'm not asking you to name them individually, but how are these people, the people who sit on the SMC, how are they appointed? The other comment was made that there's not, whilst they're, you've allowed people into public meetings and more meetings have been held and it's got more transparent, that the votes that are taken by the SMC are not made public. Could you maybe explain that?
On the first point, SMC has really, from the beginning, led the way in terms of involving public partners and the industry as full voting members of the committee. So the committee includes three public partners and three members of representatives of the pharmaceutical industry, nominated by the appropriate groups, as well as managers, finance, chief executives, and a range of clinicians, doctors, pharmacists, nurses. So it is a very diverse group with, I believe, all the appropriate stakeholders. The other factor we take into account, of course, is that we want representation from all the health boards in Scotland. So we try hard to make sure that the committee covers the whole of Scotland in terms of the territorial health boards wherever possible. So we try to balance it that way. The SMC is a consortium of area drug and therapeutics committees. So the representatives are, the clinical representatives are nominated by them. We don't go out and pick people. We ask for nominations and then try to choose the nominations that best fit the necessary mix of both skills and geographical representation. So that's your first point. The second point is about voting. Now, this point was raised by... I've looked through all the written submissions here to see, but effectively this clearly has been raised by a few of the pharmaceutical companies, and I have some understanding of why, and also by the ABPI. We changed to a system of paper ballots for the votes, paper votes, when we moved to meeting in public. And that decision was made by a committee which included representatives of the pharmaceutical industry. We were told quite clearly that we could not reveal the result on the day because of possible effects on the share price, both locally and internationally, and other commercial and maybe some other considerations as well. So we could not use the previous method of either an obvious consensus or a show of hands. We've moved to this method, which I think is the most appropriate, both on practical grounds and on the grounds of transparency, because we can assure the public that they have seen every bit of the discussion of that medicine. We have the entire discussion to the end, and then we ask for a vote. The votes are taken away, they're counted, and then they are announced to the committee in a very short private session afterwards. We do not discuss the medicines again, because that would not be in the spirit of full transparency. So the only exceptions to this are sometimes in a very few cases, I think 7 out of the first 125 submissions, where we had to have a short private session to discuss commercial in confidence information. We handled that by referring members to the paperwork rather than speaking the figures in order to, as I say, allow the whole discussion to take place in public. Now, I could go on, but I suspect you don't want me to, about why it would be very difficult to change.
The one point you haven't answered me, is there a patient? I know it's hard right across the board, but, you know, different organisations, patient representatives, you know, is there intention or is there a patient representative on SMC?
There are three public partners who have, as it happens, extensive experience, both personal, some and in the healthcare context. I think you may be referring to whether or not we should have the patients presenting the PACE statement, and that's something we will consider. That was not recommended by the Task and Finish group, which was the basis of our new process, but I think it's something that will be considered in the review.
Thank you very much.
Malcolm Chisholm on this team.
To be reminded of the origins of the SMC and how it was set up to be different from NICE, but I mean, there were problems in the past, obviously, in terms of making sure that boards actually, this might be a question for the Cabinet Secretary, implemented the decisions of the SMC. Is that a problem that no longer exists, or I mean, do you audit the extent to which boards do follow and implement the decisions of the SMC, or are there still sometimes problems with
them? I am not aware of any systemic problems with boards implementing the decisions. I mean, I think the numbers wouldn't be as they are if that was the case, because we would see, and we're not seeing the kind of any kind of standouts, if you like, that are running counter to the direction of travel of other boards. So I'm certainly not aware of any particular issue.
No, I think in many ways this has been one of the real success stories of boards speaking to each other, and there has been now a new collaborative around boards speaking to each other around their area drug and therapeutics committee, hosted by HIS as well, so they may want to comment on it. So that's had success, is really in sharing that best practice. The current timeframe in which government expect boards to take decisions on SMC advice is still within 60 days of publication. So, and boards are reaching that, and I think that's important as well. But the other issue around, the wider issue around the collaboration, is that more consistent communication of boards' decisions should happen across Scotland, and I think that would be important going forward. So we definitely want to see that collaboration between boards, area drug and therapeutics committees continuing. And I think that's been one of the success stories of the kind of new framework.
Thank you. And simply to add to that, that one of the mechanisms that Healthcare Improvement Scotland has, again, very deliberately put in place to support this is the collaborative. And the reason for that is to address any perceived inconsistencies or differences in time frame between the SMC decision and its implementation on the ground. Our sense is that a number of the perceived differences are to do with inconsistencies of language, right down to issues of vocabulary and the way the process locally is being described. So while on one level it may sound a little mundane or trivial, we're finding that the material that we're providing to the collaborative and shaping with its members around consistent use of words and description of the activity on the ground is actually beginning to help dispel any perception of inconsistency or failure to implement, so that over time we think the greater consistency will help this enormously.
Bob Doris.
Just very briefly on that, 14 area drug and therapeutic committees, glad to hear there's a collaborative now. That's a heck of a lot of area drug and therapeutic committees for a nation of 5.2, 5.3 million people. Is the review going to be looking at how they can work closer together and start to integrate a lot more of what they do? Understanding with managed clinical networks as well, a lot of that's already starting to take place. So will that be part of the review as well?
Yeah. I mean, we've been encouraging more regional working and regional planning of services more generally, and you know, in this area that would apply as well, and there's work underway.
There is, and I think boards themselves are exploring how more regional structures might operate in practice, and we see that already in clinical practice in some areas across Scotland. I think that helps the communication and the collaborative that Angiolina Foster referred to earlier will help that as well, and that consistency of information.
Okay, a couple of wee brief questions just to follow up on the, I think Richard Lyle covered the issue of voting, and we allowed a good response on record that gives some balance to what we've heard. But I think there were, beyond the pharmaceuticals, there was a discussion that was taking place by practitioners and some of the patients' groups that there was a need for greater clarity. They could go to these meetings. They got a good hearing in some cases, and when they were mystified that had been turned down because there was no indication. So they were asking themselves, are they being listened to? And I think there was a call for greater clarity behind the decisions that were taken, an explanation. Is that something that you accept, and is it something that will be addressed by the review, or indeed addressed? Professor Fox, I think it's...
Yes. Yep. We do accept that it's something we should certainly look into and see if we can provide better explanations. We accept that. It is also true, though, that it's sometimes quite hard to provide a full explanation because of the amount of material, particularly about cost, that is declared to be commercially in confidence. So there is a problem with giving a really full explanation. That's only part of it. But I do think this is something we will try harder to address in the review process. I think that's probably all I should say on that point.
Yeah.
It's something we'll look into.
I think what we're trying to do is reflect the written and oral evidence.
Yeah.
And
the other point, could I just make one other
demonstrate
point?
We are listening, I suppose. That's...
The other point is the PACE statements are always presented very powerfully to the committee. And as Angiolina said earlier, I do always remind the committee of the powerful influence they should have on decision-making. But of course, even a powerful PACE statement accepted doesn't necessarily mean that the committee is going to accept the medicine for all the reasons we've discussed before.
Yeah. I think there's no question for greater clarity in and around these things. And,
sure.
That is. I mean, you know, in our previous work, it needs to be said that I think we recognise that some of the work of the SMC was was at the forefront, not just here in the United Kingdom, but, you know, was an exemplar as to other similar organisations struggling with the issues that you've been struggling with. And Bob Doris mentioned it earlier, and I just need to get some clarity on it, because we are hearing evidence in terms of whether this whole process is fit for the future, that we have got medicines now being given breakthrough status by regulators. And, you know, if the SMC is going to be continue to be in the forefront of this work, then what are we going to do to address that issue of breakthrough, where the evidence, as we've heard from the oncologists, is maybe not as good as you would expect with other types of medicines and new drugs. So how do we ensure that SMC is fit for the future on that breakthrough issue?
That's a very good point, it has to be said. And one of the major challenges that will face SMC in the coming years, it's also something that we have discussed with similar international groups around the world. They're all facing the same kind of issue. First of all, it is something that we're working on, and we'll have to come up with some mechanism in the future for dealing with the relative immaturity of the data that you referred to, because medicines are coming to market earlier. Let's say they're getting their approvals earlier. The SMC as a one-off process, albeit with the possibility of fairly early resubmission, it may not be applicable to all of these medicines, and we may have to look at some kind of conditional acceptance with a review based on the kind of real-world data that we've been talking about that needs to be collected about the benefits of the medicines when they're used in NHS Scotland. So the answer is yes, it is something that we're seriously considering.
But not something that's been covered by the review itself? Yeah.
I think it will be, if I could maybe add as well, it's very difficult, I think, to use patient data presently in a kind of systematic way to allow those health economic assumptions. And that is in the real life situation, I suppose. So the Scottish Government is providing some investment to Greater Glasgow Health Board to work with Pharr Institute and others to look at the clinical effectiveness of cancer medicines in the real life setting. So not just about access, but about how they are used. So that will give us some information on medicines accepted by SMC and perhaps what that might point to in the future. And I think absolutely the concept of investing in new medicines on the basis of little evidence, so earlier access to medicines, is definitely going to, I think, be a major decision in terms of what we do in going forward, as with other HTE organisations as well. But we expect that these types of suggestions will be put forward as part of the independent review, and we would wish to see evidence around that, both nationally and internationally.
Okay. Can I thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and the colleagues that are with you here this morning for the evidence given and the time you've spent with us. I think last week the patient groups and all of those stakeholders who engaged with us showed an appreciation for the progress that has been made with the Scottish Government and the committee, and I think there's an element of satisfaction that we can take from that, that the committee working with the Scottish Government and others have made some progress here, but evolution was the word that was being used, and I think the Cabinet Secretary reaffirmed that today. More to be done, but progress being made. Thank you very much for your input this morning. Let's suspend at this point till we set up for the next panel. We now move to the fifth item on the agenda today, which is subordinate legislation, one affirmative instrument. As usual with affirmative instruments, we will be, have an evidence-taking session with the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing and Sport and officials on the instrument. Once we have asked their questions, we'll have the formal debate on the motion and the instrument. The instrument we're looking at today is Public Services Reform, Social Work Complaints Procedures, Scotland Order 2016 draft. Before I introduce the panel on the record, I want to acknowledge that the committee has reached a milestone today at this meeting. We welcome our 1,000th witness this session. And I'm sure that members would agree with me that witnesses play a vital role in this committee's work. Committees are the gateway to this Parliament, then we are nothing without those who are prepared to engage in it, give us oral and written evidence, and inform all of our work. So we're very proud of the level of engagement, and anything that we have achieved in terms of our reports is to the credit of those who have engaged with the committee system in the Scottish Parliament. We welcome this session here today. Our 1,000th witness is Fiona Collie, Policy and Public Affairs Manager, Care of Scotland. I'm not going to go 1,001, 1,002. But Beth Hall, Policy Manager, Health and Social Care Team, COSLA. Paul McFadden, Head of Complaint Standards Authority, Scottish Public Service Ombudsman. And Ian Smith, Policy and Parliamentary Officer, including Scotland. And Marie Allison, Director of Fitness to Practice, Scottish Social Services Council. Welcome you all here this morning. Given the time, we're going to go directly to questions. And the first question is from Malcolm Chisholm.
Well, I'd like to thank all the witnesses for their evidence, which was very interesting to read. So if I could just kind of start with a general question, and I suppose the paper from the Ombudsman explains that really this is going to align, as I understand it, align the procedure with the health procedure, which they already deal with. So perhaps the Ombudsman representative can confirm that. Will the two processes now be identical, which does seem to make sense in an era of integration, but I suppose for those who have concerns, it would also be interesting to know if the Ombudsman process will actually lose anything. Will it consider all the range of issues currently considered by the complaints review committees, and will a more centralised procedure result in any loss through losing the locality dimension of the current situation?
Thank you, committee. I think just as a kind of general background, we've raised concerns over a number of years since the single report on complaints handling around the areas of social work, social care more generally, where there have been multiple complex routes to complain, different statutory processes in place, and with integration, a feeling as that was approaching it, maybe it was a missed opportunity to align these. Over a number of years, we've been aligning complaints handling processes within the public sector to a standard model procedure of two stages with timescales and standard requirements around governance, etc., and how they should be handled. And the exceptions to this were in the area of social work and relation to health, and that's because there were separate statutory schemes in place under the Patients' Rights Act and under the Social Work Act and Directions. We have been commissioned by the Scottish Government. We've been working on the back of a Health Council report to bring the NHS complaints process into line with what is now the standard practice across the rest of the public sector, and we're well underway in that process. That procedure will be in place for the NHS from April 2017. So that's one element of this area that we have raised as complexity. The other area will, of course, be the social work process, which they will align. They will be the same process. They will have the same standards within that. I think quite crucially, from the complainant's point of view, there will be one single process, point of entry, one joined up response, you know, key requirements in there to make sure that they're not having to engage with different agencies on a complaint that spans over different services. So this is something that we feel will bring a very clear, simple and consistent process for people complaining about services in this area. In relation to the second part of the order, the Complaints Review Committee, this also dates back to 2008 when the Single Report recommended that the SPSO take on the role of the existing Complaints Review Committees. It is almost universally, from what we can see, accepted that the Complaints Review Committee system is not something that has been operating effectively. The proposals to give the Ombudsman professional judgment on top of the wider maladministration role that we have in relation to our standard role would be the role that is currently undertaken by Complaints Review Committees. So we would have the same role as the Complaints Review Committees in that regard. Clearly, this is an extension of our remit as it stands. The benefits of giving the Ombudsman the professional judgment role is it aligns with what we have had in relation to health complaints for a number of years, where we do investigate on the basis of clinical judgment. You know, so at the moment we would see complaints that maybe cross over both areas and decisions are made by joint agencies. At the moment we can only look at judgment in relation to those elements made by the health board. We can't look at that in terms of local authority. The proposals that are outlined will mean that we can now look at those types of complaint holistically in terms of, you know, so there's a clear alignment there with the integration agenda.
Any other witnesses who concur or got a slightly different view? Ian, I see you anxious.
Chair, I think there was a question was about the whether or not it might lose some of the locality issues from the CRC, and I think the general view is of users is that the CRC system just didn't work, it didn't deliver for service users. We wanted a review. What we've seen over the last few years, and this committee's been heavily involved in that work, is a number of pieces of legislation which have come through for social care, which provide a background of rights which should be defined on a national basis, and therefore it makes more sense for those to be addressed through a national complaint system, so that there is some consistency in how complaints are dealt with. So there's issues such as the Social Services Self-Directed Support Act, the Public Bodies Joint Working Act, the Carers Bill, which is currently has just been passed. All of these set certain principles and guidance as to what levels of service people should expect should be based on the rights and dignity of service users, giving them choice and control about participation in public life. Now, all those things are national guidance delivered locally, but where that fails to be delivered, where people's choices aren't properly respected or their dignity is not respected, we feel that that should be a nationally based complaints procedure which looks at those things to ensure that the national principles that have been agreed by this Parliament, by this committee, are actually delivered to individuals.
Okay. Fiona?
And then I think I would just like to agree wholeheartedly with what Ian has just said. I think seeing the SPSO and role in isolation, it wouldn't be clear, but the involvement of the model complaints handling process, I think the two parts of it, to make an aligned system that is very, very clear to people who use services and carers about how they make a complaint, how that complaint can be resolved, the timescales for that, and that they have exactly the same route to make a complaint about health and social care or an integrated service. I think that's a significant step forward, and I think will reduce confusion and enhance clarity for people who are making complaints.
Beth, and then Marie.
Okay. It was just to say that our members were broadly supportive of the recommendations of the short life working group that looked at this originally and made some recommendations in January 2014. Now, obviously, the nature of the statutory instrument that we've got before us today doesn't go into a level of detail around how some of this would work. So I think our members had a couple of concerns with the proposed changes, and I think initially it's around the alignment with the model complaints handling procedure that is in operation across other areas of local government services, and which Mr McFadden has just said there will be further work to bring the health system closer towards that. While we would welcome that in terms of the consistency that Ms Collie's just highlighted, I think we were concerned that the current social work complaints procedure allows 15 days for the initial frontline resolution stage, that first stage, whereas it's just 5 within the model complaints handling procedure. So one of the things that we would want to see is that 15 days remains. And the reasons for that are that in terms of social work, when you think of it in comparison to other local authority service areas, you can see that just by its very nature, it's more complex than those other areas. We're looking at very often relationships which can have been beginning to go wrong by the time it gets to this stage. And secondly, cases that lead to a complaint are often the more complex ones. So we would be looking for assurances that there would be that 15 days would be maintained. I think secondly, in terms of the extension of the SPSO's role, to consider not just maladministration but professional judgment. Again, our members were broadly supportive but did have some queries or concerns around what professional expertise would be drawn on in fulfilling that role, and also how the interface with SSC would work, because currently SSC have the role in relation to looking at professional judgment and indeed malpractice. So those were a couple of points of clarification. And finally, just to pick up on the issue around the local versus national focus, certainly I'm aware that the Sinclair report did highlight the need for providers to be able to resolve complaints more locally, not less. Where we would want there to be some clear thinking is around what would that look like on the ground, especially for more vulnerable groups, if we had a centralised process? So would people have the opportunity to have a face-to-face hearing, perhaps with the support of advocacy services, or is it proposed this would all be done as a paper exercise? Or indeed, if it was going to be a centralised face-to-face approach, what supports would be there for people to participate in that? So it was just a couple of thoughts on the issues that have come up so far.
Marie?
Thank you. Yes, as the professional regulator of the social service workforce, we do currently consider any issues in relation to the professional judgment of social workers. So whilst we're absolutely broadly welcome of simplification and streamlining of complaints procedures, we think it's important that we would have to work closely with the SPSO to try and avoid duplication or unnecessary lengthening of investigation times, both for the person bringing the complaint, but also for the worker whose professional judgment may be called into question.
Is there any stats on the length of investigations? Just that's been mentioned a couple of times. How many are resolved within the 15 days, or how many? Have we got any stats on that?
I don't have that to hand for today. Sorry.
Malcolm, do you want to follow up?
Very useful and interesting. So just to summarise in terms of what's been said. So on the one hand, Paul McFadden was saying that you've got to bring the health one into line with the rest, but not. So basically, it will be the issue of professional judgment that distinguishes social work or health from everything else. Is my understanding right, or will there be other differences from that?
In terms of the ombudsman's role, that will be the key difference. In terms of the local process, there will be a number of.
And in terms of Ian Smith, in a kind of way, I was surprised, you know, comparing it with your written submission, you seem to be more positive because you did have this concern in your written submission that the SPSO's decisions are not binding. So in a way, you would like it to go further.
We would, yeah. I mean, I was answering the question that you'd asked rather than necessarily what was in our submission. I mean, our view is that for certain aspects of the decision-making that the SPO should have the right to overturn the local authority decision.
So that goes beyond any powers that the Ombudsman...
In terms of the powers that the Ombudsman will have over the Scottish Welfare Fund, they will actually be able to change a decision and actually impose an alternative decision. Our concern is that for many of the issues which we're highlighting in terms of things like social work packages, for example, that if the Ombudsman investigation determines that perhaps the social worker has decided that X is required, but the local authority has decided they only have the resources to provide Y. The Ombudsman says you should provide X. Yeah. The local goes back to the local authority and they say, no, we can only afford Y. The service user isn't any better off, so we feel that in certain circumstances, the Ombudsman should have the right to say, no, you must deliver service X, otherwise you're not meeting these national criteria which have been established. In terms of social care charges, for example, if a local authority isn't taking account of disability-related expenditure in determining the contribution that a person has to make towards social care charges, the Ombudsman disagrees with what's happening. How does that actually change things if the local authority just decides not to accept the recommendation of the Ombudsman to change it? So it doesn't actually give a right of appeal, and therefore we don't think it's actually ECHR compliant. It doesn't actually meet the requirements to have a right of appeal. On that. There are many other areas where that's the case, self-directed support packages, for example, portability when you move from one local authority area to another area where you may find that you're having difficulty getting your package transferred. So there's a whole area where we think that the powers that are proposed here do not go far enough.
I mean, that's interesting, the point of ECHR, because presumably
I don't want to interrupt this conversation, but it's pretty interesting. But Beth has been trying to get in for a wee while as well. She might add to some of it as well. Beth. Is that okay? It's okay. I said it was okay.
It's just to pick up on three things there, really. A colleague mentioned the welfare fund and the fact that the Ombudsman can overturn decisions within that context. It's really to highlight that the welfare fund is very different. It's a national fund, which local government simply administers. We don't set the budget and the money is ring-fenced, and we have to follow national guidelines in doing that, including on eligibility. In terms of social work services, local government sets the budget and is accountable to communities for how that's then managed, and those decisions are subject to local eligibility criteria. So, as you can imagine, we would see any ability for the Ombudsman to overturn those decisions as interfering with that local democratic accountability that councils have. And so the fact that equates to there being no appeal was mentioned. People are able to appeal decisions, for example, around SDS resource allocation. Yes, that is an internal process, but in the wider context of this complaints process, you still have the judicial review available to people, which I understand is absolutely the last resort. So, I mean, to my mind, I don't have any legal advice on whether the judicial review element of that is compliant with the HRC, but I would imagine Scottish Government colleagues might be able to advise on that.
Anyone else who want to contribute at this point, or before I let Malcolm back in, Fiona?
I think I'm a little bit concerned that we're trying to put in place something that we want to be able to seek resolution for people, whether that be a complaint about the allocation of a budget or about a service that's not working effectively, or about someone's a professional judgment. What we don't want is people to have to go to judicial review. Not only is it expensive, but it adds an additional layer of stress to carers and people who use services. So I think, you know, whatever direction we go with this, we need to make sure that within it we focus completely on seeking resolution, and seeking resolution, one, at the earliest stage if we possibly can. But when it does get to the point of the SPSO, that we can seek within that a resolution that's appropriate to everybody. That may be a compromise, but.
But Paul, I'll let Paul in, and then.
I think that's the most important point. Is that we have in place processes that allow someone to take their dissatisfaction with a decision to an independent body for a review of that decision as to whether it was reasonable. The discussion so far, since 2008, and various consultations have been around fixing a broken complaint system. I think if government and parliament wanted to look at an appeal system, then there's a whole, you know, different discussion that would need to be had. Now, we've said before that in taking on this role, which we think will give people an administrative justice route to challenge decisions that have been made in terms of the social care assessments, when we have this role and we start to see that there is a need for something more, then that's something we would report to government and to Parliament if there is that need identified. We're not aware of anything that's there that would suggest that there is that need at the moment. And clearly that is not a decision for the Ombudsman to decide whether it's an appeal or a complaints route. But I think we do feel that the proposals as outlined will maintain people's administrative justice rights and give them a right to approach an independent body to assess whether the decisions were reasonable. I would agree in relation to the Scottish Welfare Fund that it is a very different scheme. The Welfare Fund is essentially an appeals route. The role we have will be replacing a previous role which the Independent Review Service at the DWP had, which had this role. It's a national scheme, as was highlighted by my colleague, with clear national guidance that's applied. That, you know, there's clarity there at a national level that maybe isn't existing in relation to social work. So there are differences there.
Malcolm, okay. Are you okay? I think Ian Smith wants to come back again.
I just want, in response to the best point about local discretion, I think we understand that the social work departments have discretion and it's therefore more difficult to have an appeal route around the discretionary decisions. But what I'm stressing is that the national legislation now sends a framework which sets certain rights and principles behind social work legislation which social work authorities have to abide by, and it's in those cases where they're failing to abide by that people should have a right to a review and an appeal if their right to dignity has been not delivered because a local authority has decided they cannot afford to provide overnight care for someone, then that is something which they should be able to challenge without having to go through a judicial review route, which is very cumbersome, expensive, and requires a very, very high level of failure in order to reach success. A review through the Ombudsman or whatever body does that would actually that allows them to say, in this case, the local authority's got it wrong and must change that decision, is what we are seeking, not necessarily a judicial review process.
I suppose the question then is, how does that square with BEF and indeed the policy that these policies are set locally in local democracy, and there isn't an imaginary decision somewhere else that will overturn that. I suppose that's what we're wrestling with, Ian?
I think it's what we're wrestling with, but the issue is that legislation, as I've said, about health and social care, social self-directed support, carers, the national care standards are coming through, all set principles which give rights to dignity, choice, control, public participation, etc., to service users, and they ought to have a system which they can ensure that those rights are being respected by the local authorities that are providing the services.
Mike's wanting to
yes, because I think this is quite an interesting and important area. And if I understand the Ombudsman's written evidence, the suggestion was that you would not take up a policy issue or a local policy issue unless it related directly to the person affected's complaint, and unless that person specifically related their individual problem to the policy area. And I just wonder how realistic that is, first of all, to an individual making a complaint to be aware of local policy, to understand the connection between the policy and their specific complaint, and whether or not you can reserve the right. If, for instance, you were to notice a similarity, a multiplicity of complaints arising in a certain area because of particular policy decisions, then whether or not you would, as the Ombudsman, reserve the right to take up to challenge that policy position, or can it only be triggered if a member of the public makes the connection on your behalf and draws it to your attention?
The way that we do look at complaints and will look at complaints in relation to this is in terms of the impact on the individual. And the impact on individual of how their care needs have been assessed within all of the framework that Ian talked about, legislation, national policy, local policy in terms of their entitlement. Essentially what we're looking at is, you know, are they getting access to their rights, and have the judgments that have been made in assessing their needs taken account of those rights? The element in our evidence around the kind of wider resource decisions was designed to kind of answer, I think, the question that the committee had raised, or certainly had been raised in evidence, and that was whether larger resource decisions by a council, whether we would have an ability to comment on those. And I think an example might be where, for example, a decision is taken to close a day centre. Now, there may be within that decision elements of professional judgment made that may contribute towards that decision. We feel that the way the order is drafted would allow us to look at that. But of course, these decisions are made in context of a whole wider range of factors, including user input, including local discretion and local democracy and resource concerns. You know, what we're trying to highlight there was, it's probably quite unlikely in our experience in relation to health clinical judgment, as it is unlikely, we could look at any specific judgments that were made there and comment on those if the person was able to demonstrate that they were impacted or there was an injustice or potential injustice on them.
With the greatest of respect, you've just kind of almost repeated back to me what my question was. And the point is that, you know, if the person making the complaint to you can make that suggestion, what I'm suggesting in general terms is it's fairly unrealistic. You know, if I were to go out into the street and take a straw poll and ask people about local authority policies for the sake of argument, very many of them wouldn't be able to give a coherent account of local policy. So what I'm suggesting is it's a bit of a far stretch to assume that these complaints will necessarily be made in that kind of coherent fashion, in an ideal world, perhaps. So, if, for instance, you were to receive a number of complaints in a particular locality that led you to believe that there was a policy problem, would you then be able to analyse that overall situation and then make recommendations with regard to the policy? Given what we've heard from Mr. Smith about certain rights being kind of pretty well described and inalienable.
Yeah, I think in terms of the person bringing the complaint to us, they will bring a general description usually of the circumstances and the way they've been affected. They wouldn't necessarily identify a particular policy that has had the reason for the impact. We would go through a full process of speaking to the person to try and understand what they're trying to say, and that's something we do as a matter of course. You know, we would try and unpick what are the underlying reasons. We would look at the information given by the local authority in relation to that case and try and unpick whether there were issues there. In terms of the wider question of if there were a range of complaints in one locality or about one policy, then that's certainly something that we would see in terms of the intelligence that we are getting, or the learning that we are identifying, and that we would feed back to a particular authority on that. In terms of the way the legislation is laid out, we are an ombudsman which will be looking at impact on individual. That is just the role of the ombudsman. So recommendations on the individual case will relate to that. But we could make recommendations related to the wider policy, which would, of course, have to respect local decision-making and discretion that exists there.
Okay, thank you.
Beth, you want to come back?
I think it's useful just to be clear that the purpose of the social work complaints procedure is exactly that. It's about individuals' experience, individuals and their families' experience of services, and where that's not gone as everyone would want, that they have some kind of redress. What it's not about is examining local government's policy and budgetary decisions at the macro level, if you like. The local authority is there through the elected members who have been democratically elected to scrutinise that budget and its implementation. That's obviously subject to further scrutiny through bodies such as Audit Scotland, which can be escalated all the way up to the Accounts Commission, which can have significant powers in terms of the penalties that they can seek on local authorities if that isn't going as it should. So I think For me, it is just about remembering that this is a complaints process which needs to be responsive to individuals. Now, I accept if there are patterns emerging in those individual complaints, that there needs to be further discussion and connections made. But I think, as my colleague out from SPSO outlined, that there is the ability to do that.
OK. Bob Doris is the next question, thanks. Followed by Rhoda Grant.
I thought Beth Hall's contribution there was really quite helpful, because it's almost as if we've been discussing two different things, a complaints process and an appeals process for resource allocation at a local level, and they are two very different things. My understanding from this is the SPSO will step in and take on the powers and the responsibilities the local authority previously had to make sure within the resource allocation set at a local level, within the structures established for care at a local level, the SPSO will make sure that individual complainants have their cases handled appropriately through that process. Now, I guess some of our witnesses may wish it to go further than that, and some of the submissions clearly make that argument. But I think what we're scrutinising for today is in terms of the handling of that complaints process, where I would see the crossover for the SPSO would be, a good example for myself would be complaints I've had over service delivery issues with Cordia in Glasgow, which I hope they're improving, and hopefully that's work in progress. Be kind to them there. But if a number of what I would see as service failures occurred and vulnerable constituents were complaining to the SPSO, that might be an issue for the SPSO in terms of the process and structure of that complaint. But would the partner agency not be the care inspectorate, perhaps, to look and actually see if the quality of service was fit for purpose more generally? So for me, I don't have any concerns at all about this passing to the SPSO. I think that has to happen under health and social care integration. It'd be crazy to only look at one part of the picture for the SPSO and then going elsewhere for the other part of the picture. This just has to happen. It's the links with the quality of service more generally across a local authority or an integration board area. And what would you see the links being in the future with, say, the care inspector and the more general strategic level of care, where they would have a democratic responsibility to hold local authorities to account if they're in breach of the level of care they should be providing?
Yes, Paul?
Yeah, I mean, in terms of, obviously, the social work, we're looking at the assessment, broad-term assessment of care needs. In relation to what you're talking about in terms of registered care providers and the delivery of that care, that would, of course, the complaints would, of course, go to the care inspector, who are the national body responsible for that, and they would continue to be so. In terms of that kind of linked up, learning, I suppose, or looking at this assessment of what we are seeing and how that links up with what the care inspector are seeing in terms of delivery, you'll see the order also contains provisions to allow us to share information both with the care inspector and the Scottish Social Services Council, which will help facilitate us in providing information. Now, we work with regulators at the moment in terms of our role, but we do have restrictions in that and what information we can share in terms of individual cases. The provisions in here will make that a lot easier, and that's something that we've been quite keen on from an early stage that we're able to make as easy as possible for us to feedback into that national regulator.
Are there other bodies that you should be sharing with? So we've got SSC, we've got the Care Inspectorate. Who else is out there that perhaps would have an interest in having that information and taking that? Because there's checks and balances in the system. I get the fact that local authorities are democratically elected and democratically accountable, but there are checks and balances in the system. We've mentioned two organisations that are part of that check and balance in the system. Are there any others we should perhaps be adding to that more generally, or have we got the balance right?
Fiona?
I wondered whether the role of the Mental Welfare Commission, which certainly looks at individual issues and how the two bodies will link together, and with the care inspector as well, because I think at the moment it can be quite confusing for carers and people using services about who it is they complain to, who it is that they get support from if things are going wrong. So I think some clarity around the role of the Mental Welfare Commission in relation to the SPSO would be useful.
Thank you.
Anyone else? No. Thanks, Bob. Rhoda?
Can I just ask a question for clarity as much as anything else to start with? Going back to previous questions about professional judgment, I'm assuming it's the local authority's collective professional judgment that will be reviewed, because if it was an individual's professional judgment, that would have been picked up earlier in the complaints process. And if somebody's professional judgment was way off, that would have been an issue for the SSC rather than the SPSO. Is that correct?
We work generally is that we are looking at the judgment of the organisations, we're looking at the actions of the organisations, and we report decisions against the organisations. Clearly, you are looking at individuals making judgments, but we are quite keen to emphasise that it's been the collective organisation. The interaction with the SSC is one that, you know, we've already committed with the SSC to kind of exploring further in terms of developing the existing MOU a bit further and so forth, and understanding exactly when we may want to cross-refer, you know, where that higher threshold perhaps has been met in terms of the actions of the individual. we have experience in other areas of working with regulators. The GMC would be the most obvious example, the General Dental Council and others as well, and we have in place arrangements there that have worked very well since we've had these powers in relation to health. But it's something we'll work very closely with partners to make sure we get right.
Thank you.
Hope and expect that employers were making referrals to us at an early stage if they were identifying there were any issues with professional judgment of social workers, individual social workers coming out of the complaints process at an early stage. But we anticipate that it's likely that there may be cases where the Ombudsman may be at a later stage identifying issues, and if so, we'd be hoping and expecting that there would be close working between the two bodies to try and ensure that was dealt with as effectively as possible.
Thanks. Can I ask about hearings where they take place? I would imagine some of this, I know currently with the SPSO, that some of this is kind of a paper-based exercise where there aren't hearings. But if there are hearings, where would those be held? Because I know certainly with SSSC, I've had concerns from constituents about having to travel quite a distance to access those. If we're talking about kind of people who are requiring care services and quite vulnerable people having to travel to access hearings, that would surely put pressure on them to withdraw their complaint because they might not be able to access that. What support would be available to them to attend that as well?
Yeah, I think that hearings, we won't be undertaking hearings as a matter of course, and that's not something we think is necessary in relation to these or other complaints. We're quite clear that we have the power to undertake that. We actually have the power to go as far as putting people under oath, although we've never had to use that. So we will undertake hearings where we think that is necessary to get, you know, underneath this, to understand the circumstances of the case, and also, to be honest, in the interest of fairness, I think in terms of how we will carry those out, we're going to have to speak to Ian and other subsector organisations and users as to how we carry that out. We have been having some discussions on this in relation to the Scottish Welfare Fund role, which is about to come in for 1st of April. So we've had some helpful feedback from Inclusion Scotland members and users on that system, which we'll transfer over to this. But I think this, you know, assuming the order goes ahead, this is the start of a process of discussing how that should be put in place and taking account of the needs and respecting the dignity, for example, of individuals in that context.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions for committee members? No other questions at this point. Is there, Ian, yes, I'm just about to do that. Ian, you've got a quick moment to, you know, maybe cover issues that you feel you want to put on the record as well as the written evidence, and I offer that opportunity to the others, a quick brief roundup, because we've just sent for the Cabinet Secretary who we're meeting next. Ian.
It was just to follow up on the point that yes. The Paul's just made. I think it's important that recognition is made by local authorities and the government that there will need to be advocacy support available to service users who wish to raise complaints. I'm not sure that's been recognised in the financial memorandum behind this particular order, and I think that does need to be recognised that there will be costs associated with having an effective complaint system, both for health and social care. So that is quite important. I think just one other point I just want to make is that we are aware from anecdotal evidence that many service users do not wish to make a complaint about assessments they've received in terms of the social care packages because they are frightened that if they do so, their packages may be cut further. So I think it's important to bear in mind that they do need that support, the advocacy support, to give them the confidence to challenge decisions they think are wrong, because at the moment there is certainly anecdotal evidence out there that people are very concerned about SDS assessments, for example, resulting in cuts in their packages, and that if they challenge them, that they may get cut further.
On that point, are any others, any other witnesses want to put anything else on the record? Fiona?
I think I would like to re-emphasise that, the point about advocacy, but also to emphasise that there's a real need for advocacy for carers, that there is a reduction in services across Scotland, and certainly there's new guidance coming out about developing new services, and advocacy for carers and people who use services is vital, and we really need to look at how we build a network across Scotland to support making complaints, but also actually resolving issues in the first instance.
Okay. Beth?
Yeah, just
two things, really. In relation to the costs that have been mentioned, we would want to see further work done to look at what the costs of the new system might be, and in part that will depend on the choices that SPSO make around having physical hearings and where they would be. So it's just to flag that issue. And then secondly, we would be looking for guidance around the new system to be co-produced with organisations such as Inclusion Scotland and carers organisations, the SPSO and COSLA. And I think that would be an opportunity to pick up on some of the issues around advocacy and how vulnerable people can be supported that we've been discussing today.
Have you done any work on the costs associated with reducing the 15-day time limit to 5?
No, we haven't, and we think that, firstly, sorry, it's to extend it, sorry, I'll start again. No, we haven't. We think that as it's currently 15 days with social work complaints procedures, what we're looking for is it to be maintained at that,
yes,
when the new system comes in, so it would be the same at that stage.
Uh-huh.
I suppose the costs I was referring to were more around stage 3, which is the part that's changing significantly, and we've talked today about it perhaps being a more centralised approach. So it's specifically that part of it.
I was just trying to get a weighting about the benefit to the person making the complaint as against the impact of reduced, doing that in 5 days is 15 days, whether it be a resource implication there for mm-hmm. yourselves or whether it be an additional cost. I presume that the 5 days were taken because that is part of a model that we expect public services to respond in the first instance within 5 days?
Yeah, I mean, Scotland is unique in that it has one standard process across the public sector, and the aim of the 5 days is to enable empowerment of staff to resolve things very quickly close to the point of service.
Uh-huh.
And we've achieved that in services. 80% of the local authority complaints are resolved at that stage. We have flexibility in there because we recognise that some judgments might take a little bit longer and we need to kind of enable people to kind of make those without having to escalate unnecessarily. That flexibility exists already in relation to the CHP. There was kind of minor suggestions in terms of the working group, which we fully understand in terms of the context of vulnerable social work users that we will take account of. Just in terms of the cost point, I think obviously it's important that this independent service is resourced effectively, that it is to be an effective service. One of the key things in there will be, of course, recruiting advisors, which we do in relation to health, because if we are making decisions on the judgments, it is important, as Beth said earlier, that we have access to solid professional advice. So that will be part of the cost as well, and that's something we'll work closely with the government and others on.
Thanks for that. No other... Can I thank you all for your attendance today and your written evidence and your oral evidence today. Thank you very much. We appreciate that. Suspend at this point where we change the panel. we now welcome, for the second time today, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing and Sport and officials, Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing and Sport, Mike Liddell, Policy Manager, Integration and Reshaping Care Division, and Victoria McDonald, Senior Principal Legal Officer from the Scottish Government. And we are expecting, Cabinet Secretary, a brief opening statement.
Okay, well, thanks, Convener, for inviting me to give evidence to the Committee on the Public Services Reform Social Work Complaints Procedure Scotland Order. There is a long history of discussion around the current system for social work complaints, going back to the Crerra Review in 2007 and the Sinclair Report in 2008, which called for the streamlining of the complaint system for social work. What our draft order proposes is fully in line with the recommendations in the Sinclair Report. Our intention is that the changes we'll make will shorten the time scales that a service user faces when making a complaint and brings the procedure for making a complaint about social work into line with those procedures for health and other local authority complaints. In all of these cases, the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman is the appropriate external body to investigate if necessary following internal consideration of the complaint. The order extends the ability of the SPSO to consider discretionary decisions taken in the exercise of the professional judgment of social work staff. During the course of our consultation on the draft order, some respondents raised concerns that there may be an overlap of functions between the SPSO and the SSSC, which is the regulatory body for social work staff. The SPSO and the SSSC already have a memorandum of understanding between the two organisations, and this will be updated to ensure there's a clear delineation of the roles of the two bodies. The order also allows the sharing of information between the SPSO and the Care Inspectorate and the SSSC where appropriate, should something important come to light in the handling of a complaint. During the consultation and responses to the committee's call for evidence, some respondents highlighted the need for the SPSO to ensure that they have appropriate independent social work advice in reaching decisions around professional judgment. I can confirm that in the same way that the SPSO receives professional medical advice in its investigation of complaints into health services, it will ensure that it has professional social work advice in its investigations into social work complaints. If the draft order is approved by the Parliament, the SPSO will work with stakeholders, including service user representatives, to produce a model complaints handling procedure, which will be published before the SPSO takes on the function for social work complaints in April 2017.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We now move directly to questions. Our first question is Malcolm Chisholm.
There, it brings the social work complaints procedure into line with health and other local authority. I can't read my own writing. Complaints, I think. But more specifically, it brings it into line with health. Is that right? Because of this professional judgment factor. I think most people would say this is a good idea in an era of integration. But one concern that was raised was that it might not be easy, in the oral evidence we've just heard, is it might not be CHR compliant in the sense that the Ombudsman could not direct a local authority to follow the decision that he or she had arrived at. I mean, have you sort of considered that dimension of it, or is that not something you would agree with, presumably?
Firstly, on the first bit, I mean, I think we recognise the importance of ensuring that complaints are joined up from the perspective of the complainants, and health boards and local authorities have to agree and set out within their integration schemes their arrangements for managing complaints that relate to the delivery of services that are within the scope of integration. So I hope that, you know, that give some reassurance that there will be a synergy and coherence there. I mean, in terms of the ECHR issue that you raised, I mean, I think it's important to remember that SPSO is fully independent of local authorities. So the criticisms which, you know, have been previously made about the links between complaints review committees and local authorities are being dealt with in these reforms. I mean, ultimately, in the same way as judgments around health. It is for the public body in a very public way to then implement the recommendations. And that's how it works for health and other services, and that's how it will work for social work. So, you know, it would be unusual, to say the least, if a public organisation was to turn around and say, well, I know that that's the recommendation and the complaint has been upheld, but we're going to ignore it anyway. That really, in reality, doesn't happen. Mike, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
I think Mike does it.
Okay, no, okay. I understand the point you're making, because I think in practice that is what happens. Yeah. But obviously that was a concern that was raised. I mean, your first point there was really interesting, because I think this has come up in a different session that we had, because, I mean, this is really about what the Ombudsman's going to do, but I kind of assumed when the integration boards were set up that they would deal with complaints, but are they still going to be dealt with separately, as it were, by local authorities and health? I think that's what you were kind of touching on in your first part of your answer there. But
so, well, I mean, the integration scheme has to set out the process which a service user and anyone else complaining on behalf of a service user may make a complaint, and the arrangements set out in the integration scheme don't alter the underlying position that complaints are to be dealt with under existing health and social work complaints procedures, but that the health board and local authority must ensure that the arrangements that they've jointly agreed are clearly explained, that they're well publicised, they're accessible, and they allow for timely recourse. And of course, they have to also ensure that people are signposted to independent advocacy services. So, you know, I think at the end of the day, if you're a service user, all you want to know is that your complaint's going to be dealt with. You know, the way that's then dealt with behind the scenes needs to be consistent, and it needs to be joined up by both bodies working together and ensuring where there's something that perhaps spans the services of both organisations. And in the world of integration, you can envisage how that those services may be services going into someone's home, for example, that are delivered jointly by both organisations. So there has to be a kind of synergy in the way it's dealt with, but it will be legally, I guess, dealt with under the auspices of both organisations as set out in legislation.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Bob?
Yeah, maybe just pick up some of the evidence we heard in the last session. So one of the concerns that was certainly raised by Cosler was the 15-day window that they currently have in relation to with complaints at that most local level, and that the national consistency is 5 days. We were told there could be discretion in relation to that. How would we make sure that in practice that appropriate discretion was shown, I suppose, and maybe an opportunity to roll a couple of questions together in relation to this, is again when you have people without social work expertise making professional judgments on those with it. And we heard again from the SPSO they'd be looking to recruit people from that context. But I suppose it's just to make sure what oversight government would have to make sure that happened. So those were two concerns from groups who obviously support this reform. But just to get on record, hopefully some reassurances you can give in relation to that.
Do you want to answer that?
In terms of the question of 5 or 15 days for the timescales at the frontline resolution stage, during the working group that Reverend Graham Forbes chaired, that was one of the issues that was raised. So we're going back to 2013 on that, and we did listen to that. And one of the things that we've committed to in producing the model complaints handling procedure, which SPSO will do in collaboration with the service users, with other organisations, they'll be looking at that at that stage, and it is an issue that has been raised consistently, and we would expect that to be addressed in that model complaints handling procedure. And officials from Scottish Government will be working with SPSO and those organisations to ensure that that guidance is appropriate for service users as well as for local authorities in producing a good complaints handling procedure for social work.
And that there would be relevant SPSO employees with substantial
Yes, absolutely. The resources that will be provided to the SPSO to enable them to take on the functions will ensure that they can take on social work professionals to ensure that there is good professional oversight of any of the the issues that are raised to them, and there will be social work professionals working with SPSO.
Okay, I suppose the last question I would ask, Convener, to reiterate one of the questions asked in the earlier session, and that was in relation to, not for the first time, whenever a complaints process comes up, the theme very quickly turns around to appealing decisions that local authorities have made, and in various other pieces of legislation, that certainly was so much the lobbying that MSPs get. There are financial decisions that local authorities make that I may or may not always agree with, that directs a resource allocation towards meeting service and addressing need. And the complaints process will look at how people go through that system rather than the overall allocation. However, where there's a service failure for individuals because not enough care is provided, SSSC may have something to say about that, the care inspectorate may have something to say about that, and I'm pleased that there's information sharing arrangements in place. It was suggested by Fiona Collie, maybe the Mental Welfare Foundation may be a relevant body as well. So I'm just wondering whether you'll keep that under review about how we can share that information as much as possible to put those really important checks and balances in the system.
Yes, and I think, you know, one of the most important aspects of a complaint is then how the organisation learns from that in terms of improving practice and the way things are done. And you're right, it's really important that there's a joined up, where the dots are joined up with the SSSC, Care Inspectorate, and indeed Mental Welfare Commission, so that there are, if there's information that comes to light during a complaint that may have wider implications, whether that's for the conduct of individuals or whether it's about the service more widely, then those it's very appropriate that those other organisations are able to take that and take it forward. I mean, we use a number of routes to that in the health service. So, for example, patient opinion, if something is raised there that could be of particular concern, you know, we would expect that would be looked into, particularly if there's issues of concern for individual welfare. So yes, and I think that one of the most important aspects of this change is bringing it together, because at the moment, as I understand, they're not allowed to share any information, or actually, unless there's... do you want to explain?
At present, there's a threshold that has to be met before the Ombudsman is able to provide information to other organisations such as the SSSC or the Care Inspectorate. So the purpose of the amendment made in this order, adding them to the schedule, is to allow them to do so in a wider range of circumstances where they think it would be relevant to those bodies' functions.
And just to check, obviously it's the Mental Welfare Commission, not Foundation, of course, I got that wrong. You'll take a view maybe going forward of whether that's an organisation that should maybe get a greater degree of information sharing as appropriate?
Yes, I mean, I think that's something we'll have to consider. They're not explicitly listed under these provisions, but it's something I think we'd want to give some consideration.
Yes, I mean, from the work that we've done on it, I don't think it had come up in any of the consultation responses to the quite extensive work that had been done. I suspect, but I am talking off the top of my head, I suspect it's to do with the nature of exactly what role the Mental Welfare Commission has in sort of individual cases as compared with the role of the Care Inspectorate and the SSSC. There's nothing to stop, if it's appropriate, that being done in a subsequent order, but as I say, I'm not aware that it had come up in any of the consultation to date.
I'm sure pretty much that was my last question. What it was going to be, Queen, was in relation to just making sure that, you know, with guidance and regulations, this is the kind of thing where you keep a weather eye on it and update it as appropriate. This is not job done. This is transition made and followed through on an ongoing basis.
Yeah, we'll definitely continue to monitor.
Okay. Just a couple on the detail, but one maybe on the strategic. The national care standards, how important are they in providing points of reference about how services are delivering. I'm going to say it anyway, it was 2011, 2012 that the committee recommended the review of the national care standards. When will they be in place? Will they be in place before 2017 when this is in operation? And how important will they be to what people can expect in terms of their delivery on the ground?
Yes. They are very, very important, and yes, my understanding is that they will be, that the time frame, there's synergy there from recollection, but I will confirm that, I'm sure it is. And yes, I think that backdrop of the standards that are expected will be an important reference point for service users and the SPSO. What I'll do is I'll get a note back to the committee.
Appreciate
just confirming
that.
The time frame on that.
And on the detail in terms of the 5 or the 15 days in terms of complaint handling, and I think we are focusing on timely resolution. Mm-hmm. So the 5 days meets that requirement, and I think we know as MSPs that can be very, very important indeed to ensure that it doesn't become a full-blown complaint, that issues are satisfied, etc. So it is an important element of it. I suppose the next stage is what meaningfully can be done to ensure that in that 5 days advocacy can be put in place, that the individual is fully aware of their rights, the local council policy in regards to their complaint, and be supported in that complaint. Is it realistic that all of that can be put in place in that 5 days, and that complaint can be handled and dispatched efficiently? Or will that become a problem in itself? If we're setting an unrealistic 5 days, then we're going to get breaches and people are going to be complaining that they haven't been here within the 5 days. So the detail and the practicality is there, I suppose. And I've got one final question, and that might as well do the is how do we ensure, for instance, if it's a question on a social works person's professional opinion, how do we ensure that we can get the appropriate person involved at that very, very early stage to review, have the skills to review that professional opinion that is cause for complaint?
Well, on the last point, I mean, there's good experience of doing that in the health service. So when it's a health service complaint, the Ombudsman is well experienced now of being able to bring in the right expertise that can provide the level of advice that they need. So essentially it will be the same. It may take a little bit of time maybe to build up those contacts, and you know, but I would imagine there's a good template there of being able to apply that to social work services, which of course are there is a big range there, from services to children, older people, people with learning disabilities. The expertise required there in terms of giving advice will be a bit different, but I would assume that the Ombudsman, Michael, will maybe say a bit more about this, but would have that bank of expertise that they would then draw upon. And the first point, I mean, I understand your concern there. I think if it's a case of someone perhaps with additional support needs who may need quite an intensive advocacy input in order to be able to take the complaint forward, I think that may be a challenge within 5 days. I think it should certainly still be the aim, but there's also an issue about doing it properly and making sure that the person's concerns are expressed fully. And I suppose it's that balance of trying to deliver that within 5 days, but losing the ability for the person to actually have the opportunity to express their complaint properly. So I suppose that would be the balance. Mike, do you want to?
I was going to say, I think it's important to be clear as well that the 5 day period is really just for the frontline resolution. There is the stage after that where it would be a senior manager would look at the complaint. So it is really focusing on getting it right and getting that change made at the very first stage. And we will be providing SPSO with sufficient funding to ensure that they're able to... So I know that's more for the local authority side of things, but we'll provide SPSO with enough funding to ensure that they've got the advocacy support for people coming into them.
So to meet the requirement of the legislation in the 5 days, we just need to acknowledge the complaint and say it's been investigated. That would meet the requirement. Is that what we're saying?
No, I think what we're looking at is to try and resolve a complaint at the first stage wherever possible. And what we're talking about in terms of the 5 and 15 days is the aim to try and resolve a complaint within 5 days to start with, but with the possibility of extending that to 15 days should either the local authority or the complainant need additional time to do that.
And in the circumstances where it might be somebody with quite profound additional support needs, it may be more appropriate to take that little bit of extra time. Mm. But ultimately, those would be judgments that will be made.
Brother Grant.
Just on the point of advocacy, I pick you up that people with additional support needs would get advocacy, but it may be that people putting in a complaint are quite vulnerable. I mean, people receiving support services would probably require advocacy as well. And is that built into the whole process, both within the appeals process to the council itself and onward to the SPSO, that they would have access to advocacy, taking that forward?
Yeah, I mean, my understanding is that advocacy is there for anybody to use who requires it. I don't think it's for defined cases. And that you want to?
Not that I'm aware of.
No, I mean, my understanding is that in some ways that would be kind of self-selecting. Is that your understanding?
That is my understanding.
Yeah. So if someone asks for advocacy and helping to make a complaint, then if I'm understanding you correctly, I don't think you've got to fit into a particular... I think it's the person feels they need support in making the complaint. They determine that themselves, by and large, if they require that advocacy. So we'll have to monitor to make sure, of course, that it's adequate to meet the needs. And I'm sure the SPSO will, you know, be keeping us fully informed about whether they feel that the resources are meeting the demand. These are things we'll have to monitor as we go along. But that's my understanding, that it's self-selecting.
And another issue that might require more resources, if hearings are required, getting the hearings to go out to the people rather than have them travel. It can be quite distressing if people have to go a long way from home, stay overnight and go through the process as well.
Yeah, and again, that will be... these things will be judged, I'm sure, by the SPSO on the needs of the individual concerned. I mean, if someone has very limited mobility, for example, it may be absolutely right that people would go to the service user rather than the service user being expected to go to a central point, the SPSO's office or whatever. So, yeah, that would be my understanding. Yeah.
Okay. No other questions for committee members? Thanks for that, Cabinet Secretary. We now then move to our next item on the agenda, which is agenda item number 6, which is now the formal debate on the affirmative SSI, which we have just taken evidence. Can I remind the committee and others at this point that members can discuss issues with the Cabinet Secretary, but should not put direct questions to her during the formal debate, and of course officials may not speak in the debate. Can I now invite the Minister to move motion S4M15465?
Formally move.
Thank you. Is there any member wish to contribute to the debate? No. No member wishes to contribute to the debate. The Cabinet Secretary, is there anything else that you want to add? No. Okay. I put then the question, which is that motion S4M15465 be approved. Are we all agreed?
Aye.
We are agreed, thank you. And I now suspend at this point and thank the Cabinet Secretary and their colleagues for being with us. Thank you. To agenda item number 7, which is subordinate legislation. We have two negative instruments before us today. The first instrument is the National Health Service General Dental Services Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016, /53. There has been no motion to annul. Members will be aware that the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has commented on the drafting errors in the SSI, and the Scottish Government has confirmed that it intends to lay a correcting instrument early in the new session. I invite any comments from members. If there is no comments, I put the question that the committee. Are we agreed that we make no recommendation?
Agreed.
Thanks. As agreed, the second instrument before us is personal injuries, NHS charges, amount Scotland Amendment Regulations, SSI 2016, /59. Again, there has been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Any comments for members? No comments. Can I take it from that? The committee agreed to make no recommendations. That is agreed then. Thank you. And as previously agreed, we now move into private session.